Okay, let's keep going. So we talk about GABA triggered the iPSP. So what's that? So in the synapse part, that's the area neurotransmitter is released. These neurotransmitters, if they can open the sodium channel or open the other channel, make the insight become more positive, we call that EPSP, excitatory postsynaptic potential. So we're talking about the voltage. Most neurotransmitters, after they've been released, they can trigger the EPSP of the postsynaptic neuron. But some of them, they can actually make the insight more negative with an IPSP, inhibitory postsynaptic potential. So we have EPSP, we have IPSP. Apparently, these two potential, it happens in the synapse. It happens in the synapse. So you found the neuron, they have a lot of synapse. The other neurons want to talk to this neuron. And they're going to release neurotransmitter. So a lot of them are EPSP, excitatory postsynaptic potential. But some of them, they can open the ligand-gated sodium channel, so make the insight become more positive. So more neurotransmitter release, more EPSP. And some of them can release GABA. And GABA can open the chloride channel. So when they release more GABA, more chloride flow in, insight become more negative. And this is called the IPSP, inhibitory postsynaptic potential. And in your brain, you have 100 billion of neurons. It's like one neuron just connect with one. On average, every neuron receives hundreds, if it's not thousands of input. They actually look like this. So a lot of them connect with the dendrite, but when the dendrite are all covered, the synapse can connect with the cell body, the soma part. So these neurons receive hundreds, if not thousands of input per millisecond, because we talk about the it just take about millisecond for this process to happen. It's like you, every millisecond you receive 100 people yelling at you, EPSP, SQ, generate action potential, IPSP, SQ, don't generate action potential, because when you need to have a bigger EPSP, right? They reach the threshold, and eventually when the signal summation together go to the axon hillock, it's big enough, you're going to generate action potential. It's like every millisecond you hear people yelling at you, generate, and the others say, don't generate action potential. We're going to drive you crazy. No wonder your brain uses so much ATP. They are pretty busy. Your brain have 100 billion of these neurons, and each one receive hundreds of input, if not thousands. So every millisecond, this neuron receive input, and each synapse release neurotransmitter. They can create the EPSP, and most of the situation is each one of them is actually not big enough to reach the threshold. But that's okay. They receive hundreds of them, right? And each one of them can release neurotransmitter once, twice, three times. This is called the temporal summation. Especially the neuron responds so efficiently, they're going to release neurotransmitter and open the sodium channel, okay? EPSP, not big enough. But before it go back, replication back to normal, it generate another one, release another neurotransmitter. Okay, this is the temporal summation. This is temporal summation from one neuron. And they can reach the threshold, trigger the action potential. They can also have the spatial summation. Spatial summation is not from the same neuron, not from the same synapse. So even though each one of them is not big enough to trigger the action potential, but every neuron on average receive hundreds, if not thousands of input, and their summation together can reach the threshold. All they care is when they reach the trigger zone, the axon hillock, is the signal still supra-threshold? If it's still supra-threshold, it will generate action potential, start from the axon hillock and go all the way down to the axon. So this is a spatial summation. And don't forget the inhibitory. Most synapses excitatory, but some synapses, they're inhibitory synapses, like the GABA. We talk about GABA. You open the chloride channel, it can make the inside become inhibitory. And it's like every millisecond, this neuron, we see people yelling at him and say, okay, generate, don't generate, generate, don't generate. Eventually, it's the summation for all of them. Reach the trigger zone. If it's supra-threshold, it will trigger the action potential. If it's sub-threshold, it won't trigger the action potential. And the connection, I told you, is not one neuron connect with one neuron. So when they connect, they can diverge out, the axon can diverge out, connect with more than one. Or a lot of them can converge together. So if you think about the connection, in your brain you have 100 billion of neurons. And each one receives 100 of input, and the connection is not fixed. And they can connect with hundreds of others. They can converge and diverge. When you think about the possibility of the neural network, well, it's infinite. And that's what makes your brain unique. If you have a damaged liver, you want to have a new liver. If you have a damaged kidney, you want to have a new kidney. You never heard people want to have a new brain because it's not you. It will be another person come to take over your body. What makes the brain so unique? Because the neural network. Your neural network has been shaped by the past 20 years of your life experience. And my neural network has been shaped by the past 40 years of my life experience. So even though we both have the same kind of brain, the same 100 billion of neurons, and the neural network makes us unique. So your consciousness, your emotion, your memory is different from mine because this connection is totally different. That's what makes the brain unique. Okay, let's stop here.